Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Richard Bausch, is known as one of America's finest novelists. Well, it's true, because he has a new book called Before, During, and After. Except it's no and, it's just Before, During, After, and it's published by Knopf. Welcome, Richard.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, what a pleasure. This book is mesmerizing. And it's mesmerizing in a way that you don't know where it's going to go. Oh, it's a surprise.
That's good to hear.
Yeah. So let's tell our friends about Washington, D.C., Natasha, who is a senator's assistant. And she's, what, 32 or 3?
Mm-hmm.
And she's invited to a cocktail party, part of the, you know, what goes on in Washington. And at the party, she meets a man who has been a priest, and his name is Falk.
Michael Falk.
But she refers to him always as Falk, and then in her subconscious, she thinks of him as Michael.
Yeah. No, it's me referring to him as Falk. And his father has always made the joke that all they're missing is the N-E-R, and
yeah,
he would have a lot of money, Faulkner.
Right. Leander says that. But at the party, they meet, they go off, and he's lonely. He's a lonesome man, and he has decided he will leave the priesthood.
Mm-hmm.
That must be quite a schism for a human.
Yeah, especially at his age. I mean, he's 48, going to be 49, and he's been a practicing Episcopal priest for 20 years. But it occurs to him that, you know, he's doing a job, that it's a job, and he isn't, his heart isn't really engaged, and he begins to feel fake.
It was interesting. You wrote that he felt he was listening to everybody's problems and troubles, and in a sense, who's listening to mine?
Yeah, I think that was part of it. And of course, there's also the fact that his wife at the time began to feel the pressure of being the minister's wife and having him attend to everyone else's troubles. And she also felt an essential sort of gloominess about
it.
You know, he thinks of joy as something tinged with the knowledge of the other side of it. I think there's a place where it talks about the little veins in the cheek of a baby, and those are the insignias of mortality, and so that joy is always mixed with that. And she thinks of it as a refuge, a place where you don't have those things going through your mind, and that's the essential difference between them.
Both Michael Falk and Natasha have relatives. There's Aunt Clara, or Grandma Clara, and Iris, Grandma Iris, to Natasha, who's an incredible woman, because she had brought Natasha up after her parents were killed in Alaska.
Yeah, in a, they were in an actual accident. I had to look it up to be sure, but they were in an accident. It's a cruise ship fire, and I can't remember now what the name of the ship was, but it went down on its way to Alaska, and they were going to move there, and he was going to be a cook. And he was a trained cook, and that's what she wanted. She wanted to move to Alaska. But they left Natasha, who was only 3, with her grandmother Iris while they went to take care of things, but they never made it there, and they jumped into the water off the coast of Vancouver, up in the north,
yeah,
and we're gone forever. So that's her
yeah,
past is this
sadness,
yeah,
loss,
this catastrophe. Yeah,
yeah. But in Washington, there's Clara. She's like a grandmother, and someone for Natasha to go to. But she's, you know, women by 32. Have had entanglements, affairs, and Natasha's no different.
Mm-hmm. That's true. And the thing about, I have to say, I want to, you know, Aunt Clara is modeled after somebody. Most of my characters are just made up whole cloth, but the two in the book who are actually modeled after someone, Clara is modeled after my Aunt Florence, who's 86 now and still, you know, just as strong and powerful a woman as ever.
Where does she live?
She lives in Virginia. She lives near my brother Bobby, so uh-huh. Every time I go back, I see her. Iris is modeled in a way. If there's a model for Iris, it would have to be with my wife Lisa's mom, who hasn't had that kind of tragedy, but she's had some real bad things to deal with in life, and she went ahead and, you know, became a real estate person with a lot of power in Niagara Falls, you know, after...
Oh, they're all over the country.
Yeah, everybody's everywhere.
Because I should tell our friends in the audience, at the end of the book, you talk about how you wrote this book. And I mean, there's a litany of places that you were at that I wondered, how had you kept the continuity?
I think that whole thing is the result of the invention of the netbook. I mean, laptops, I think, are wrongly named. They're flat computers, but they're too heavy. And but these little netbooks, you can take them anywhere.
Yeah.
And, you know, I had a head injury in Galway, Ireland, and I was sitting up because if I laid down, I was dizzy. And I would sit up and nobody bothered me. I couldn't sleep. So I would work on that net.
Yeah.
I was working on the book.
The before part, let's tell friends. The before part is that week before 9/11, at the few weeks where, you know, America, the beautiful, and it was beautiful. And then the during is 9/11. That night, I remember calling my sister in New York and saying, Joan, have you seen what's happening? Mm-hmm. And we all did that. But Natasha has a friend named Constance, my name, and they have gone to Jamaica because Constance is a rich, older woman. A little bit of a faux cocktail type. Yeah.
That's a good way to put it.
And everybody there is saying, as I did, do you know what's happened?
Yeah. They find out about it coming in from the beach. Everyone in the resort is gathered at this big television set in the lobby, and it's happening.
And they can't get off the island.
No, everybody's trapped. All the planes are grounded, so everybody has to stay there. And they can't get in touch with anyone. And Falk was in New York. He was up to attend a wedding,
mm-hmm.
and had mentioned to her that he was going to go up in the Twin Towers and have breakfast and look out at the city. So Natasha is terrified that he's dead, although she finds out fairly early that the towers don't even open up for tourists until 9:30. And these things, of course, happened at 9 o'clock, but she can't convince herself that he wasn't nearby or standing underneath it, and she can't, until she can actually speak to him, believe that he's alive.
And as people do at such a time, they took to alcohol.
Yes, indeed.
And a lot of drinking.
Yep.
And suddenly, what did rules matter almost?
Yeah, it's true. Somebody said to me, a friend said, this is a boozy novel. And I said, what are you talking about? I said, everybody's drinking on that island. And of course, people drink at the party for the wedding. I said, come on, this country spends $50 billion a year on alcohol.
Yeah.
I don't think we're going to have a novel where nobody's taking a drink,
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a very moderate drinker. I drink about a glass of wine or two at dinner, if I have anything lately. I mean, I didn't have anything yesterday or the day before. I just didn't think to. I love the taste of wine. I love the taste of whiskey, but I know enough not to...
You get the buzz and stop.
Yeah, just, let it flatten out a little, calm yourself, and then...
But unfortunately for Natasha, there's a man named Diego. Describe him for our friends.
He's a man who speaks in a very formalized, almost as if he's saying prepared speech, but it's the way he learned to speak English. He came to America from Cuba through Canada, and his father brought him there. And he tells Natasha that his wife has left him for another woman, and he makes a pass at Natasha, and because she's half drunk and desperate, and desperate isn't the word, desolated, depressed and in grief, she kisses him and then says, no, I don't want this, and she smokes a joint with him, and then he passes out, and she goes into the water and goes down the beach and goes up on the sand and falls asleep, and Diego is on her when she wakes up. She wakes up and somebody's grabbing her from behind, and he rapes her.
But doesn't just rape her. He does horrible things of sticking sand in her mouth, and that she thought she was going to die.
She was sure she was dying. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's packing it because she kicked him. She got up and kicked him. There was nothing passive about her response. She was wildly fighting the entire time, and so he started using the sand to make her
sorry.
Yeah, and to make her sorry.
Yeah.
And he keeps saying, you know, I do not take what has not been given. And he writes a ridiculous note to her saying in Spanish, I might have loved you. And it's just so awful. And then her friend Constance saw her kiss him before anything happened. And she supposes that Natasha has indeed had an affair with the fellow, and that she feels differently about going back to Memphis. Well, she feels differently, but that isn't the reason. And, of course, the fact that she's trying not to let to report it, to just live past it, changes the way she behaves.
Yeah. Where did you study women? Because it's peculiar how tuned in you are to women at such a time.
My friend, a good friend of mine, a wonderful writer named Danzy Senna, she and her husband Percival Everett live right here in L.A. We were sitting at dinner, and I said to Percival, that's a neat shirt. I really like that shirt. And Danzy said, you're such a girl. And it made me feel really good.
Yeah. What did your wife say?
She laughed. She said, yeah, he notices stuff like that. Yeah. I mean, it's like he's one of us. But, you know, maybe it's having had the sisters and
four daughters. Did any, I hope to God not, but did anything like that ever happen to any of them?
No.
Yeah.
Thank God. Well, because 7 out of 10 people don't report it, I'm supposing it's never happened.
Yeah.
I have to say that in a way, Natasha, there are things about Natasha's living in France for a period and all of that, that my wife, Lisa, her parents are reading the book, and they're saying things like, I can see stuff of you in here. And Lisa laughs and says, you know, I'm his muse. Yeah. It's all right, you know.
And then, of course, she had the broken romance with Mackenzie.
Yes.
It's also when now we get to the after. And she finally gets out of Jamaica, and we're into what do you do now? She's supposed to be married in a few weeks. Michael is waiting for her. He's gotten a house in Memphis. And what does she do? And that, I say to you, every book club is going to have this as a discussion period.
Does she or doesn't she tell? Why won't she tell? And of course, one of the reasons she can't tell is she believes that he, because of his past as a priest and as a religious, mm-hmm. and he's still very religious, a part of her, although I don't know that it's expressed outwardly in the novel, but it's there, I think, is a fear. There are places where it says she feels as if he's a child and she's the adult, that she doesn't really think he could handle it if he knew the whole story, if he mm-hmm. knew that she'd allowed the man to kiss her or smoke dope with him or any of that. Not to mention the fact he has a bare outline of the previous relationships, but but even, you know, you see him at one point thinking about those relationships in a brutish, selfish way, as if, you know, he wanted everyone she's ever known to have been obliterated.
You do something, too, within the book where you become like, where he becomes judge and jury for himself.
Yeah.
And you do it as a lawyer would do it, breaking it up to different points, but then what would she, and it was interesting that you would do that. Totally
that really
different.
Surprised me. I had no idea that was going to happen. And when it did, I thought, oh, this is interesting. I mean, this is going to be fun. I mean, I can move time forward by having him say some things about how things have been. And I just thoroughly enjoyed doing it. I wanted to make sure I had it exactly, you know, in the pattern. And it is quite a jolt. I mean, when I read it, when I got it from the publisher, to turn the page, they're hearing music on Beale Street on the honeymoon night, and I turn the page, and there's Article 1, and there's this whole thing. I'm proud of that, though. I think it was a good thing to do. People have spoken.
It's creative. Yeah. But they get married with a terrible minister who is doing a homily and just a terrible person. And that has nothing to do with two people who are getting married, supposedly in love and happy. And she has to act. She is acting. And anybody who's had to act in a relationship, it's exhausting.
Yeah, yeah. And that's, to me, that's the real drama of the book, is her.
Yeah.
Her success and in some ways lack of success at trying to act her way through to get beyond it. And there are places where she feels like she's beyond it, but as soon as she does, it comes rushing back.
And she finally does something that is taking at least a step for herself. She calls Orlando, where he lives, to announce that she has been raped and who it was and where he lives. But you know, it's so true. The woman who she's talking to said, you won't win.
Yeah.
You'll only hurt yourself.
He says, I'm asking you these questions. These are what the lawyers will ask you, sweetheart. That officer's name is Lorraine Brown. I made that name for her. It's the name of one of my dearest professors when I was in college, when I was in my 20s. Two of them, I'm going to get Helen Garson in the next book. In some honorable place. Both of them were just marvelous.
Where were you from, Richard?
I was born in Georgia, but raised most of my life in the D.C. area.
Uh-huh. Father involved with the government?
No, he was a soldier. Well, I mean, when we were born, he was just back from the war.
Yeah.
So that's why we were born at Fort Benning, Georgia. But and then he sold cars. He was something. He was one of the best people I ever knew.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear.
Well, he had this thing, and I'm so grateful for it. He taught all of us. He had six kids, and we lived in the South, Virginia, and during the time when, you know, Virginia was
non-civilized.
Yes. Yeah. And he drummed it into us in the most insistent but gentle way. Everybody one at a time. Everybody one at a time. You don't look at people and see any member of a group. You see a person.
Yeah.
And I mean, that has stood me in such good stead. And even to the point of understanding early, and I'm rather proud of it, that kudos, no congratulations accrue to me for seeing individual people. That's a given.
Yeah.
That's the minimum. I mean, you see people congratulating themselves for being tolerant. Like, what? You know, what am I, you know? But that's just the way the whole culture is sort of imbued with it. It's kind of sad. It's as bad now as it ever was in some places.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Excuse me.
Just curious, when did you start writing? And who encouraged it?
My dad. And my mom. I was about 17, maybe a little younger. And I started trying to write poems. Well, I thought they were poems.
Yeah.
And what are you doing? My dad said. I said, I'm writing a poem. And he said, is that iambic pentameter? The line looks like an iambic pentameter line. And I thought he was speaking a foreign language. And I said, I don't really know what that is.
Yeah.
And he handed me Romeo and Juliet. And he said, here, read this. This has got plenty of it in there, and you'll get a feeling for it.
Michael, at one point, starts to fantasize that she has bumped into someone she had known, maybe this Mackenzie, because he had come across a picture of her on State Street in Chicago. Mm-hmm. The happy, I've never been so in love, so happy on the back of it. And he starts to form it in his head. This is what, and why is she doing? And finally, he gets so riled that he busts the door down. She comes out frightened and, don't do this to me. And she turns to him and said, I was raped. And it's such a shock.
It's such a shock to him that he staggers back. And then the sort of expected male response, I'll kill him, who is it?
Yeah.
You know. And she just wants away from him because he has very much reminded her of what she'd been through with banging down the door and everything. And it's when he begins to realize that not only has he been so wrong, but his wrongness has contributed to her nervousness around him because he keeps judging her.
You know when someone's lying to you. You don't know it, but you know it.
Yeah.
And all she wants to do is tell him, I'm pregnant.
That's what she's waiting to tell him when he comes back from. Yeah. And her shock when he says, it's okay, I forgive you, you're my wife. Forgive me, what?
Yeah.
Forgive me for what? It's okay if you had an affair in Jamaica, whoever you had sex with in Jamaica. And that is just, she just goes in and shuts the bathroom door. She doesn't want any part of it. And then he just explodes. You know, I don't want kindness. That's what he keeps saying. I don't want kindness. You're just being kind. And it's a thing that happens in my novels, I think, where the men are not up to the women.
You've been married a long time, I assume, with this many daughters. Nobody's marriage runs smooth.
That's true.
I mean, there are not all good years. How did you come out of it?
I don't know if I did. I think learning how to have a tidal sense of things,
mm-hmm.
you know? I mean, my first marriage broke up after quite a long time in 2004 and 5, through that period. And it was an earthquake. I mean, I reached a point where I've actually written a cartoon about it. I sometimes will dabble in goofy, where these two men are standing there with a glass of wine, and a guy says, I lost my train of thought, and the other guy stares at him, and then the third frame he says, you didn't care whether you lived or died.
Yeah. Richard, thank you. What a brilliant book, and it's going to have a lot of discussion for people. Thank you. Especially, I hope it's with book clubs that are male and female, because I think it needs to hear both sides.
Yeah, I do too.
Will you autograph my book?
I sure will.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com or at YouTube Connie Martinson's channel. You can re-see the show or send a friend to see it. But support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution in America. I am sure that the librarians are going to be recommending this book for the next few years. But whatever you do, support it. Donate your time and used books, because they can use every book you send them. And don't forget, if there's a child in the family, take them, get them their first library card. They'll never forget you or where they were when they got that card. So see you next time, and thank you, Richard.
Pleasure. So much pleasure.